Okay. So when you're calculating an average value, you want to write these together. People were, had them on different parts of the page. You should write them together because this represents the measurement. Whatever the average was, you should write it like that, not separately. They really go together. Okay, that's a good practice you should get into. And on that particular question, since the uncertainty was to the thousandth place, then you write this to the thousandth place. And don't forget, each one has a unit associated with it because this represents the uncertainty in something in centimeters. So this has to have the same units. Okay. So I just want to mention that. And then one more thing about that worksheet, which I forgot to mention in lab. Don't write numbers like this. Okay, and I didn't take off points for this on the worksheet, but when you do that in the lab, you'll lose points every time you write that down. Write it like this. Okay, that's what I expect. Okay, let me see if there's questions in the chat. Okay. Let me erase this. So let's talk about the new unit. New units of chapter 23 to 25. Some of the material that you will see here is very closely related to some of the calculations you did with gravitational fields in Physics 205 last semester. So make sure you try, if you don't remember that stuff, make sure you go over it because you're going to see it a lot in this unit. This is a very calculus-based unit. Okay? This is a heavily calculus-based unit, especially compared to the other units that are coming up. The first unit we did had almost no calculus. This one is heavily calculus-based. So just be aware and make sure you remember your calculus. Okay? Today's lecture won't be calculus-based too much, but after this, it will get pretty dense with the calculus. So what I want to do today is talk about Coulomb's law, and I want to introduce the electric field. So does anybody have any questions before I get started? Okay. Oops. One second. Sorry, I have too many windows open. So chapters 23 through 25 involves a discussion of electrostatics, basically charges that are not in motion, and how do we analyze the forces acting on charges that are not in motion? And so that's going to be the nature of 23 to 25, and then the unit after that will be looking at charges in motion. So I wrote down some applications of electrostatics. Inkjet printing, electrostatic painting, air cleaners, and these are electrostatic air cleaners, by the way. Copy machines, Geiger counters. They all involve applications of electrostatics. And basically, the laws involving electrostatics, for example, the first thing I want to talk about is Coulomb's law, really is very important in science. I mean, Coulomb's law is responsible for atomic and molecular structure, and the electric force is also responsible for the properties of solids, liquids, and gases. So it's an important concept, okay, that we need to learn. So we talked about charges this morning, and we talked about properties of charge. What I want to talk about now is the force between two charges. And if you do an experiment, this experiment was done a long time ago, and you want to write down the force on one charge due to another charge. Let's say I have charge Q1 here, charge Q2 here. I want to find the force on charge 1 due to charge 2. Okay. actually, let's look at the magnitude of the force between the two charges. You can experimentally show it's given by the following expression. Some constant, I'll tell you what that constant is, times the magnitude of Q1 times the magnitude of Q2 over the distance between them squared. So let me draw in my picture. I'm going to draw a vector that goes from Q2 to Q1. The magnitude of the vector R12 is this distance. Okay. It's not a radius, it's a distance. The reason why we use the letter R, because a lot of times when we do these problems, we don't use Cartesian coordinates, we use either polar coordinates or spherical or cylindrical coordinates. It turns out that Cartesian coordinates can be inconvenient in more complex problems. Q1 and Q2 are the magnitudes of the charges, and K is a constant, it's called a Coulomb's constant. This force can be attractive or repulsive. If the two charges have the same sign, then the force is repulsive. If the two charges have opposite sign, then the force is attractive.
Professor?
Yes.
Is the R the distance between the particles, or they're like center of mass? Is that implied that it's the distance between their center of masses?
Yeah, it's implied that we're talking about the distance between the center of mass of the objects.
Okay.
And right now I'm just drawing point particles, because realistically, Coulomb's law really works best for point particles. However, objects that have spherical symmetry can be treated as point particles. So these can be the centers of spheres, okay? But I didn't draw the spheres, okay? I'm just treating right now as point particles, just a point in space. So all the charges in one little location in space. All right. So just remember, what I've written down is the magnitude of the force, not the force vector. And I'm going to show you a couple of ways to write down the actual force vector. One is the obvious way, is by drawing a free body diagram. And yes, anytime you see a force, you should think of free body diagrams. So you will be drawing free body diagrams in this chapter. Anytime you're dealing with problems involving forces, here you still got to draw free body diagrams. Okay. I need to say one more thing here about this constant K. K is called a Coulomb constant. And this value is 8.99 times 10 to the 9 Newton meter squared per Coulomb squared. That is actually a very big number, because if you remember from gravity, when you covered gravity, the force of gravity was this. This number G is 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 Newton meter squared per kilogram squared. So if you compare this G to this K, K is about 10 to the 20th times as big as G, which says that this electric force is a huge force compared to the gravitational force. So when we talk about electric forces, we look at forces between small particles. When we talk about gravitational forces, we talk about forces between very big objects like planets, because this number is so small. Okay. So let me say a few more things about Coulomb's law, when it can be used. In order for you to be able to use Coulomb's law correctly, The particles have to be stationary. Okay? The particles can't be moving. If the particles are moving, then you will have to deal with relativistic effects, which really are manifested through the magnetic fields. If the particles are moving, magnetic fields are involved, and then you're going to see magnetic forces. With small particles, it's very easy to make the particles move very fast. So the effect can be significant if they're moving. Only if these particles are really moving very slowly or almost come to a stop, can you really use Hubble's law accurately. If they're moving at fairly high speeds, you got to deal with relativity, which, and again, it's manifested through a magnetic force. Now, the other thing too is that this expression is really good for, or very, really you need point particles. Okay, this equation is good for point particles. So if you have two spheres whose radii are small compared to their separation, they're going to look like point particles relative to each other. And so then you can use Coulomb's law. If you have even a square and a square charge and a cylindrical charge that are very far apart, they're going to look like point charges to each other. You can use Coulomb's law. If you have spherical objects, perfect spheres, that are in the vicinity of each other, and this is their separation, because spheres can be treated as point charges, you can use Coulomb's law. If the system has spherical symmetry, you can use Coulomb's law. If the objects are close together, but they don't have spherical symmetry, you can't use Coulomb's law in this manner. What you would have to do is you would have to break up each object. Let's say you have, let's say a cube. And let's do the cylinder. And you want to find the force on the cube due to the cylinder. What you would have to do is break up this cube into a small particle, and you would have to break up this cylinder into a small particle. And what you would do is find the force on the little particle, the small piece that makes up the whole cube. You have to find the force on it due to the cylinder, which means that you'd have to integrate over the whole cylinder. And then you would have to integrate over all the pieces that make this Q1 up together. So you'd have to do 2 3-dimensional integrals. So basically it's a 6-dimensional integral. It's very inconvenient to use this for these kind of particles. Fortunately, there's other methods to solve those kind of problems. Okay. So again, really, you want to use Coulomb's law when the particles are stationary and the particles have spherical symmetry, or they're point-like. They act like point particles. Okay. If the charges are moving, you have magnetic fields that are produced. And so this equation is not valid. Coulomb's law implies if there's two forces in the vicinity of each other, two charges in the vicinity of each other, then those two charges will experience a force. Coulomb's law cannot explain the case when a charge experiences an electric force in the absence of other charges. There are such circumstances. These occur when electric fields are induced by changing magnetic fields. Coulomb's law is nice for stationary particles, but it's not an equation that can be used in all cases. We will come up with an equation that can be used in all cases later on today. So I want to say a little bit about Coulomb's law, when you can and when you can't use it. You should know when you can and when you can't use it, or when you shouldn't use it. And again, Coulomb's constant is 8.99 times 10 to the ninth. It is way bigger than the gravitational constant. So just for fun, let's compare the electrical and gravitational forces between two electrons. You know these equations. I mean, in fact, if you compare the gravitational equation to the electric force equation, they have exactly the same form. They depend on 1 over r squared, the product of two scalar quantities, and some constant. So let's say we have an electron. The mass of the electron, 9.11 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms. And again, there's no scale that can measure that. It's measured indirectly. Let's say they're separated by 1 meter. Okay. And the Q for these is 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. So I want to calculate the gravitational force of attraction between them. And I want the magnitude, right? I want the magnitude of the force between the two, okay? And that's going to be 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11. I am going to not write the units in because otherwise I'm going to run out of space. I apologize for that. The two electrons each have a mass of 9.11 times 10 to the minus 31. And then I divide by the distance 1 meter between them. I'm going to do the same calculation for the electric force.
Professor?
Yeah.
The mass should be squared, right?
Yes, thank you. I was thinking in my head and then I forgot to write it down. Thank you. So I'm going to do the same thing with the charge. I'm going to square it, okay? Okay, so if you calculate, I'm not going to calculate the values. I'm going to calculate the ratio of the electric force over the gravitational force. Okay, that ratio is approximately 10 to the 43rd. It shows you how much stronger the electric force is compared to the gravitational force. It's completely insignificant. So, for example, if you are studying an atom and you're looking at the structure of an atom, you want to calculate something about the atom, you completely ignore the gravitational force because you have to go 43 decimal places beyond the decimal point to consider the effects of the gravitational force. It's a very small force, okay? You know, only if the charge is very small compared to the mass can you really look at these two forces comparatively. And you'll see some problems in the textbook where the charge is comparatively small, is quite small, and the mass is significant, so that you can actually look at these two forces on a more comparative basis. There's problems in the book where, I'll give you an example. Where you have, for example, two charged objects on a string they're given the mass and the charge, and you want to find the angle between them. That's a physics 205 problem. But the charges and the mass have to be the right value so that this number is, you know, a decent value. Okay. Otherwise, you're going to get 10 to the minus 20 degrees. Are you okay so far? Okay. Sorry, Chase. Just let me know if I didn't write the 2 there. Even though sometimes I say it and I don't write it, I apologize. Okay, so now what about writing it as a vector? I can determine the direction of the force from a free body diagram, okay? But we can write it in a very formal mathematical way too. We can write Coulomb's law in a very formal way. So again, let me draw my two charges, Q1 and Q2. We can write this as a vector in the following way. The force F is equal to the Coulomb constant times Q1. Notice I am not putting the magnitude of the charge here. Q2 over R12 squared, excuse me, times R hat between 1 and 2. R hat is the unit vector that is directed from 2 to 1. And I should put down 1 to 2 here, sorry. Okay. So R12 is the unit vector that goes from 2 to 1. It goes from the source of the force to the object in question. It goes from the source of the force to the object experiencing the force. That's how that vector is written. I'm sorry?
Should the length of the vector be smaller than that?
Should the length of the vector be smaller?